चमन बगल जो है मेरे को बताओ
सबसे ऊपर वाला सबसे ऊपर
ये बस
क्या करना
बस अपना लेक्चर स्टार्ट कर दिया
एक बार शक्ल दिखा दूँ हेलो आई एम डॉक्टर एन एस राज क्लिनिकल फार्माकोलॉजी आई विल बी टेकिंग लेक्चर ऑन ड्रग्स यूज फॉर सेक्सुअली ट्रांसमिटेड इन्फेक्शंस
लॉगिन कर लिया बच्चे ने ठीक है ना स्टार्ट कर लीजिए
स्लाइड्स में नहीं है इसमें अटेंडेंस कैसे होगी इसमें
वो सब इसी में होगी
नहीं
इसी में होगी बच्चे जो लोग इन करते हैं
ये सब स्टूडेंट्स हैं चेयर वगैरह सब सैनिटाइज है कोरोना ने बहुत डरा दिया था
ठीक स्टार्ट
आई इंट्रोड्यूस माई सेल्फ आई एम डॉक्टर एन एस राज क्लिनिकल फार्माकोलॉजी
थोड़ा लाउड बोलो
स्पीक माइक इधर नहीं है
अच्छा
इसी में आई एम डॉक्टर एन एस राज क्लिनिकल फार्माकोलॉजी आई विल बी टेकिंग लेक्चर ऑन ड्रग्स यूज फॉर सेक्सुअली ट्रांसमिटेड डिजीज एक्चुअली देयर इज नथिंग न्यू अबाउट इट द ड्रग्स विच यू हैव ऑलरेडी लर्न अबाउट द एंटीबायोटिक्स antiviral drugs, antifungal drugs, and antiprotozoal drugs, antiemetic drugs, they will be discussed in this in relevance to the sexually transmitted disease. Most of this lecture is covering the clinical part. In this lecture this clinical part may appear to be irrelevant but it will be useful for you when you go to clinics so std focuses on symptoms of genital ulceration rash irritation pain swelling urethral discharge this peritoneum and this uvula. So in these patients, immunization of hepatitis A, B is important, alcohol intake is important, and drugs used for recreational purpose is also important, and sexual patterns and sexual behavior of the person is also important, and what type of sexual practices they are making. These things are important to understand the sexually transmitted disease. And what contraception they are using, are they using condoms? So this should be noted in the history of these patients. The important thing is that these diseases can be transmitted to the mother and to the child in pregnancy, and that is the most important part. So in child, this sexually transmitted disease can cause problems. In younger child, it may be sexual abuse, or in older child, this disease may be transmitted by the sex. Infections that are sexually transmitted are syphilis, gonorrhea, human immunodeficiency virus, genital herpes, genital warts, chlamydia, and trichomoniasis. And others are synchroid lymphogranuloma venereum, granuloma inguinale. These are seen in tropical countries. Hepatitis virus A, B, C, D may be acquired sexually. And recently the Zika virus is also transmitted through semen. Genital warts may ulcerate and increase the risk of transmitting the acquiring HIV infection. In this lecture, we will not talk details about the HIV infection because that will be covered in separate lectures. These patients are often anxious because they want to know what type of problem they are having and why they are having. So the staff which is attending these patients should be reassuring, they should be sympathetic, and they should emphasize that clinical attendance is confidential. These patients often present with balanitis, that is the inflammation of the glans penis, that may extend to the prepuce and the under surface of the glans, and that is called balanoposthitis. The tight prepuce and poor hygiene and collection of the smegma in this under the prepuce can aggravate the infection and irritation and other symptoms. So these patients may have candidiasis, which is associated with immune deficiency or diabetes. If the patient is taking broad spectrum antibiotic for long time, that may help, and the person may be taking glucocorticoids for immunosuppression or kidney transplant, or they may be getting the anti-mitotic drugs, anti-cancer drugs. So, and due to other diseases, if immunological condition is suppressed, these patients may develop fungal infections like candidiasis. So these patients may present with genital ulceration. The most common cause is herpes. These are multiple painful ulcers that affect the glans and coronal sulcus or the shaft of the penis. And sometimes these ulcers can coalesce and they form one solitary lesion. The diagnosis can be made by scraping the material from the lesion and sending this for culture and detection of herpes simplex virus by DNA polymerase chain reaction. The other condition could be syphilis. There is a single painless indurated lesion, or there rarely there could be multiple lesions. The diagnosis is made by the dark ground microscopy by polymerase chain reaction. Other infective causes could be varicella zoster virus and trauma, and secondary infection over the traumatic area. These patients may present with urethral discharge, and the major cause of the discharge is gonorrhea and chlamydia. In majority of cases, the infections are negative. In some cases, the infection is negative. So these are called non-specific urethritis. In some cases, Trichomonas vaginalis, herpes simplex virus, mycoplasmas, ureaplasmas, adenoviruses, and other bacteria may be detected. So gonococcal urethritis discharge is profuse and purulent, whereas chlamydial urethritis discharge is less and more less symptoms are there. If you do gram staining of the exudate from the lesion, you could see the polymorphonuclear cells more than 5 per high power field, and gram negative intracellular diplomate. Because of the mask, my pronunciation may not be heard clearly. So please be aware of this. Urine samples may be taken for the antimicrobial test. First boiled urine may be taken for the culture sensitivity or nucleic acid amplification test. When gonorrhea is suspected, a urethral swab may be sent for culture and antimicrobial sensitivity for Neisseria gonorrhea, because the microbial resistance is occurring these days, so culture sensitivity should be tested whenever possible. In older patients, one should consider the malignant conditions like squamous cell carcinoma. These patients may present with proctitis, which could be due to gonorrhea, chlamydia, herpes, syphilis. There could be mucopurulent discharge, rectal bleeding, and tenesmus. Then these patients may present with vaginal discharge. So vaginal discharge is controlled by hormonal influences in puberty, pregnancy, and by the use of contraceptive methods like oral contraceptives medicines. If there is sudden change in discharge with color and smell, and there is vaginal irritation, one should suspect the infection. The common cause of the infection is trichomoniasis and gonorrhea and chlamydia. Herpes simplex may cause increased discharge, and this can cause dysuria and vaginal pain. There could be some non-infectious causes, like there is some foreign body, or there is malignancy, or there is fistula formation. When you go to clinics, you will learn many things about these things. If discharge is homogeneous of white in color and vaginal pH is greater than 4.5, then gram staining reveals the gram variable organisms coating these squamous cells, then diagnosis is the bacterial vaginosis. If there is vaginal erythema or discharge which is curd like it and pH is less than 4.5 and microscopy reveals the fungal spores, then it is most likely candidiasis. Clotrimazole 500 mg pessary once at a night and clotrimazole cream twice daily, or econazole pessary 150 mg for 3 nights and econazole cream twice daily can be used for 7 days. Fluconazole 150 mg orally instead can be used for this purpose. If there is recurrent candidiasis, then oral antifungal should be given once a day. If there is trichomoniasis, vaginal inflammation, and there is frothy yellow green discharge, then metronidazole 400 mg twice daily orally for 5 to 7 days should be given. High doses of metronidazole can be given as a single dose, that is metronidazole 2 gram orally as a single dose, and metronidazole gel 0.75% can be applied daily for 5 days, and clindamycin cream 2% can be applied for 7 days. If there are other infections like streptococcal or staphylococcal associated with the other infection, then the antibiotic sensitivity should be done so that the correct antibiotic can be used for this purpose. Sometimes these patients present with lower abdominal pain that indicate there is some pelvic inflammatory condition, and there could be infection of the fallopian tubes and surrounding structures. So that is very important in sexually active women. So pelvic inflammatory disease includes abdominal pain, dyspareunia, pain on intercourse, there could be abnormal vaginal discharge, there could be bleeding on touch, there may be systemic features like fever and malaise. On examination, these patients may have, on TV examination, there could be adnexial tenderness or swelling or ulceration, exudation from the cervix of the uterus. And the diagnosis sometimes made by laparoscopy, and laparotomy may be required. Pregnancy test should be done in these patients because sometimes ectopic pregnancy is there, and there is some trauma and infection, and sometimes abscess formation. So broad spectrum antibiotics should be used for this purpose, and these antibiotics should be active against gonorrhea, chlamydia, and for that purpose ofloxacin or ciprofloxacin plus metronidazole should be advised. If the patient is having pain, then analgesic may be given. If the infection is allowed to occur and it is not treated in time, there could be abscess formation, scarring. So early treatment is advised. These patients may present with the genital ulceration. Like in genital herpes, there are multiple painful ulcers in the perineum, around the introitus, labia, and this patient may have fever and malaise. Diagnosis is made by gently scraping material from the lesion and sending it for culture and detection of herpes simplex by polymerase chain reaction. This patient may have primary syphilis. The incubation period is 14 to 28 days. For the patient, they have petals, that is small, very small nodules that erode skin. And there could be swelling of the inguinal lymph nodes because the infection is occurring in perineum. So inguinal lymph nodes are, and the clinical feature is these lymph nodes are rubbery and mobile and painless. This is the clinical feature of the syphilis. And they are non-tender. Non-tender, painless, rubbery. So a painless ulcer may occur. So Treponema pallidum is the bacteria which is causing this disease. And this bacteria can be detected by dark field microscopy by direct fluorescent antibody. The antibody is having fluorescent material attached to it. Then antibody attaches the bacteria and that can be seen under the microscope. So the details I need not tell. Microbiologist will be able to tell you the details. So many centers are using enzyme immunoassay for this. So they detect the immunoglobulins G or M types and if it may give the results. There could be some false positive reactions, that means the patient may not have syphilis but the report is positive, and that sometimes occurs when there are other diseases like infectious mononucleosis, chickenpox, malaria, pregnancy or some other autoimmune disease. False positive results may be there, so the test should be repeated to confirm the syphilis. Then there could be secondary syphilis that occurs after 1 month or 2 months. Development of the shrinkage, fever, malaise, headache and rash. So these patients may have maculopapular rash. There will be scale formation which result in gunmetal grey appearance. So that is the characteristic of this signature. And there could be development of thick papules called condyloma lata. And these papules are present in warm, moist sites around the perineum. And non-tender lymph adenopathy is present in 50% of the patients. These lesions may be present in the genitalia, oral cavity, pharynx, larynx. Then there is latent syphilis. The disease may persist but is no clinical symptom in 60% of patients. Then there is tertiary syphilis. In the tertiary syphilis, the granulomatous lesion develops the gamma, which is called as gamma. You may occasionally see these patients in surgical wards, and the healing of these gammas occur very slowly, and there is a tissue paper scar formation. Similarly, these gammas can be present in tibia, skull, clavicle, sternum. they could be present in the brain, spinal cord, liver, testes, and other organs. There could be, for long standing syphilis, there could be cardiovascular involvement, aortitis, dissecting any reason can occur. Because aortitis, the dilatation of the aortic arch may occur, and it may cause the weakness of the wall of the aorta. The treatment is penicillin. We will come later for the treatment. Then there is neurosyphilis. Then there is involvement of the brain, meningovascular disease, general paralysis of the insane, neurosyphilis. Cardiovascular syphilis may coexist with the neurosyphilis. Then there is congenital syphilis, that is the syphilis from the birth. So these infections can occur during pregnancy, and the fetus can have miscarriage or stillbirth, or there could be perinatal birth, perinatal death, or there could be intrauterine growth retardation of the fetus, prematurity, or the neonate may be having hepatosplenomegaly or some rash. The child may be having fissures on the mouth, nose, anus. There could be hepatosplenomegaly, chordiitis. I need not read everything. Then there could be periostitis, neurosyphilis, and the deafness, eighth nerve damage, keratitis, joint effusion, Hutchinson's teeth. That is thickened notch on the cutting edge of the teeth that you can see in these patients, child patients. There could be mulberry molars, high arched palate, maxillary hypoplasia, or saddle nose. And these things you will see in clinics if you find some patient. They could be having some deformity of the tibia, subretibia, or there could be bursting of the frontal and parietal bones in the child. Penicillin is the treatment of choice in pregnancy. Erythromycin can be given if there is sensitivity to penicillin, or 10 days course of ceftriaxone may be given. We will talk about this again. These syphilis patients, when they are treated with penicillin, they can develop anaphylaxis. You may be aware of anaphylaxis. There is difficulty in breathing, sudden increase of histamine in the body, and there could be respiratory problems. So injectable adrenaline should be available, oxygen should be available, glucocorticoids and antihistaminics should be available, then this type of reaction is likely to occur. The other reaction is Jarisch-Herzheimer reaction. This is an acute febrile reaction that follows treatment. The patient may have sudden headache, malaise, myalgia. It resolves in 24 hours. It occurs in early syphilis. Sometimes fetal distress or premature labor can occur in the pregnancy. This reaction may cause the worsening of the neurological ophthalmological and myocardial condition. For that purpose, prednisolone 40 to 60 milligram daily should be given for 3 days, and then the treatment should be started. Then there is procaine reaction. The procaine which is added to the penicillin injection can cause some type of reaction. The patient develops dysphoria, the feeling of impending death, fear. If the drug is accidentally given intravenously, for that one should be careful that the drug is not injected into the vein or other vessel. So when you are injecting, just aspirate if the blood is coming or not. If the blood is coming, then stop this. Procaine penicillin may be associated with hallucinations. The hallucinations you may be knowing. There is no stimulus, but the patient is seeing some objects. Gonorrhea is caused by Neisseria gonorrhea. It may be causing damage to the epithelium in the lower genital tract, pharynx, larynx, eyes. In untreated mothers, babies delivered may develop ophthalmia neonatal. So the child may have some gonococcal infection in the eye, and that should be immediately treated. Or the child may be having mucopurulent discharge. There could be rectal infection also. In women, urethra and paraurethral glands, like Bartholin glands or ducts or endocervical canal, may be infected. Penicillin is the drug of choice. Currently, a single dose of 2.4 megauniters of intramuscular benzathine penicillin is given. A 14 days course of procaine penicillin can be given for the treatment of neurosyphilis. And it should be supplemented by 3-day course of prednisolone, 40 to 60 milligram per day. And in this patient, doxycycline and azithromycin may be given. But these patients may have resistant infections. Then there is chlamydial infection in the man. This chlamydia infection is transmitted similar to gonorrhea. The symptoms are milder as compared to gonorrhea. They may have conjunctivitis, epididymo orchitis. In women, this infection may cause intermenstrual or postcoital bleeding, dysuria, and vaginal discharge, and lower abdominal pain and pelvic inflammatory disease. On examination by speculum, if you observe, see the cervix, there could be mucopurulent cervicitis, edema of the cervical head. 80% of these patients are asymptomatic. There may be just discharge or dysuria. Or there could be some other infections associated with this, like trichomoniasis or candidiasis. So gonorrhea can cause infection in the pharynx and oral cavity, eyelids. So gonococcal ophthalmia neonatorum is very important condition in child. It should be treated immediately. So if you examine the exudate under the microscope, there will be gram-negative diplococci. For this condition, intramuscular ceftriaxone 500 mg should be given, or an oral dose of the azithromycin 1 gram will slow down the development of the lesion. Longer courses of antibiotics may be required in conditions like prostatitis, epididymoiditis, abscess formation, pelvic inflammatories, and disseminated gonococcal infection. I should go hurriedly because so ceftriaxone 500 mg intramuscularly, azithromycin 1 gram orally, or cefixime 400 mg stat, or ciprofloxacin 500 mg orally stat, or ofloxacin 400 mg orally stat, or ceftriaxone 500 mg plus azithromycin 1 gram stat can be given. Erythromycin 500 mg 4 times daily orally for 7 days, or 500 mg twice daily for 2 weeks. Ofloxacin 200 mg twice daily for 7 days can be given. Then there is lymphogranulomaniaemia, that is caused by chlamydia trachomatis. So there are ulcers, vesicles, and papule. This is papule by mistake, peas. So in these patients, the lymph nodes are matted. They are not discrete, and they could be tender. Serological test can be done for this patient, and doxycycline twice daily orally for 21 days can be tried. Erythromycin 500 mg 4 times daily orally can be tried. Then there is synchroid hemophilus degree. There are multiple painful ulcers, and in 50% patients the inguinal nodes are involved. On microscopy, scrapings of the ulcer may show the bacteria. Azithromycin 1 gram orally can be given, ceftriaxone 250 mg intramuscularly, or ciprofloxacin 500 mg twice daily. Then there is granuloma inguinal. There are ulcers, painless ulcers. Painless inguinal lymph nodes and abscess formation. For that condition, azithromycin 1 gram weekly or 500 mg daily orally, or doxycycline 200 mg twice daily orally, or ceftriaxone 1 gram intramuscular daily can be given this day. Then genital herpes simplex. I will go quickly because I have too many. Infection with herpes simplex virus 1, happy simplex virus too. Maybe involved in these infections. The first episode presents with irritable vesicles that soon rupture to form small tendril ulcers. These lesions can occur in urethra, vagina, cervix, urogenital tract. And these patients can have fever, headache, and malaise. Inguinal lymph nodes are enlarged and tender in these patients. There could be nerve root pain in these second and third sacral dermatomes. Analgesia may be required in these patients. Recurrent genital herpes should be treated by acyclovir 200 mg 5 times daily or famcyclovir 125 to 250 mg twice daily or valacyclovir 500 mg twice daily. Treatment should be given for 1 year. Herpes infection in pregnancy may be life threatening because there is hematogenous dissemination and should be treated as early as possible. Then there is papillovirus anogenital warts. Human papillomavirus DNA typing has demonstrated over 90 genotypes. There are 90 types of herpes. Human papillomavirus mostly cause genital tract infections after sexual transmission. I need not go into details. The swabs are taken from vesicular fluid and DNA is detected by PCR tissue culture typing. The 5-day oral regimen should be started immediately. That is acyclovir 400 mg 3 times daily or valacyclovir 500 mg twice daily or famcyclovir 250 mg 3 times daily or acyclovir 200 mg 5 times daily can be given. Sometimes surgical removal may be required in the wards which are pedunculated and large enough, they cannot be treated by medicine, so they have to be removed surgically, maybe under local or general anesthesia. Then there is molluscum contagiosum. This infection is caused by can be sexually transmitted or by contact. There are flesh colored umbilicated hemispherical papules. Sometimes these are large papules. They may require cryotherapy at the very cold temperature. Nitrogen oxide is used to damage these cells, or they can be burned by diathermy or electric currents, or they can be damaged chemically by applying 0.15% podophyllotoxin cream. These warts may be caused by human papillomavirus. They could be single, multiple. So these warts should be biopsied and diagnosed. In pregnancy, the size of these warts may increase and sometimes they can cause problems in the delivery of the child and cesarean section may be required. perinatal transmission of human papilloma virus can lead to anogenital warts in the child. The use of condoms may prevent this infection, and vaccination against human papilloma virus infection has been used in many countries. Different types of vaccines are available: bivalent vaccines, quadrivalent vaccines, and nonovalent vaccines are available, which are active against high-risk types of the human papilloma virus. All vaccines are highly effective. So podophyllotoxin 0.5% solution or 0.15% cream can be applied twice daily for these warts. Imiquimod cream may be used, applied 3 times weekly for 16 weeks. Catif and extract of green tea plant, Camellia sinensis, is applied 3 times daily for 16 weeks. Or cryotherapy using liquid nitrogen to freeze the wart, warty tissue, and damage it and remove it, can be used. And high friction by applying electric current and burning the tissue and damaging the warts may be useful. Then there is viral hepatitis. This viral hepatitis is a different type of condition. It may be sexually transmitted, but the genital lesions may not be there. So, active immunization against hepatitis A, B virus is required in high risk patients. Combined vaccines are available for this purpose. Then we again talk about the medicines which we can use in sexually transmitted disease. One major drug is ofloxacin. It is less active than ciprofloxacin against gram-negative bacteria, but ofloxacin or ciprofloxacin can be used for the infection of chlamydia. It is also effective against mycoplasma pneumonia and chlamydia trachomatis. It also inhibits the mycobacterium tuberculosis used in resistant, multi-drug resistant tuberculosis. High activity against Mycobacterium leprae is also seen with this drug. So, ofloxacin seems to be better absorbed. And food does not interfere with this absorption. The drug is excreted unchanged in urine, so in urinary infections, genitourinary infection, this may be most relevant. But the dose has to be reduced in renal damage, renal failure. So ofloxacin is comparable to ciprofloxacin. And the strains of gonorrhea are sensitive to this drug. 200 to 400 milligram dose can be used. So penicillins have become unreliable for treatment of gonorrhea because resistant cases are occurring. In ophthalmia neonatorum, penicillin 20 units per ml drops are put in each eye for every 3 hours. In severe cases, 50,000 units intramuscularly twice a day for a week is given. And syphilis is important, I told you, for that 1.2 mega units of protein penicillin. Intramuscular injection given for 10 days or weekly or 3 weekly doses of 2.4 mega units of benzathine penicillin. This is long acting penicillin. Can be used for this purpose. So for late syphilis, benzathine penicillin 2.4 mega units weekly for 4 weeks is recommended, and if there is cardiovascular involvement in those conditions, the procaine penicillin 5 mega units intramuscularly 6 hourly for 14 days is used. Instead of these drugs, this ceftriaxone can be used. It has high efficacy. It is one of the cephalosporins. So that can be used for the resistant patients. A single dose of 250 mg intramuscular injection has been proven to be curative in gonorrhea. Then the tetracyclines can be used because these antibiotics are broad spectrum antibiotics. So most of the organisms are sensitive to tetracyclines. So they are useful in the chlamydial non-infectious urethritis, lymphogranular venereum or granulum in the azithromycin or erythromycin can be given in the patients who are having hypersensitivity to penicillin. So doses given is 1 gram single dose in chlamydial infections and 3 weekly doses in lymphogranular venereum. A single fluconazole 150 mg orally can be curative for candidiasis. Fluconazole 100 mg per day for 2 weeks is highly effective in oropharyngeal candidiasis. So most any infection and cutaneous candidiasis can be treated with this drug. Then acyclovir can be useful in genital herpes simplex. Can be treated by topical or oral or parenteral acyclovir. 5% ointment is available, or it can be given as oral treatment 400 mg 3 times a day for 10 days. So you can see that there is a variety of organisms which are causing sexually transmitted disease, and different type of antibacterial, anti-organism, anti-amoebic serum like metronidazole can be given a 2 gram single dose in trichomonas, or it can be given 400 mg twice a day or thrice a day for 7 days. These courses may be repeated after 1 to 2 months and both male and female should be treated, because if one person is treated, the other person is getting infection from the other. So I think that ends the lecture. You may be having so many questions, but don't worry, you will have separate lectures on the antibiotics like penicillin. Different types of antibiotics and antiviral drugs and anti-amyloid drugs, and this will be repeated in other lectures also. So thank you very much. Just finishes your lecture. Now I'm closing. Thank you. हो गया जी पूरा पूरा एक घंटे में ही हुआ है, जल्दी जल्दी करना पड़ा। अब मैं इस पर लगा लेता हूँ,
ओके थैंक यू।
अटेंडेंस वगैरह तो लगेगा,
वो इसी में होगा। ये देखो ना, ये वो देखे ना आपने, वो
देखे थे स्टूडेंट बैठे हैं, तो अब तो वो है नहीं, चले गए होंगे।
ये तो ना
मेरे को तो आया है स्टूडेंट।